We're going to talk about behavior. And when it comes to self-destructive behavior, it's not all one way. I mean, you can think about the mental side that can be very self-destructive and the physical side, which adds right to it. And sometimes they're in combination thereof. Our good friend, Dr. John Braccio, drjohnb.com for all the podcasts and Regional Psychological Services of East Lansing is with us now. Good morning, sir.
Well, good morning to you, Dave, and I think you said it well. I think simply stated that self-destructive behavior is damaging to the person psychologically, physically, or both. And I think if we want examples of psychological self-destructive behavior, it would include debilitating fear, compulsive behaviors like gambling or shopping, extreme sadness and unhappiness, not being able to relate to others in a healthy way, eating disorders, PTSD, phobias, and really physical self-destruct would include suicide, substance and alcohol abuse, risky and impulsive sexual behaviors, self-injury and compulsive behavior that results in risky physical activities that can lead to death or major injury. So these are pretty heavy things, and causes of this, really, they're varied. They can include high anxiety, risk attraction, risk aversion, extreme fear, social isolation, OCD, phobias, PTSD, addiction, low self-esteem, personality disorders, ADHD, emotional abuse, and childhood abuse. So you can see that there's a lot of causes, things that can occur this. And if you really take a look at overdose deaths in America, you can see how risky behaviors can lead to death and really for many thousands of persons each year. And then the more subtle self-destruct behavior, such as sabotaging yourself in life and not advancing in your work, love, and personal relationships. So really there are pretty a lot of ways that a person can self-destruct. Yeah. Fortunately, we can overcome them. But definitely there are a lot of things that can make life difficult for us.
The list that you put together there, and I'm sure it's a good list, but not even comprehensive. There could be more, honestly.
True.
But how many people in our nation do you think are suffering from one or the other, meaning psychological or physical? Because I think the number has got to be very large.
I would say many millions. I mean, if you really think about it, just look at substance abuse. Put alcohol abuse in there. The impact it has on persons, on marriages, on work production, on work keeping a job. You take a look at the right now the fentanyl. You look at the overdose deaths. And then just look at the people that sabotage themselves. I can't do that. I won't do that. Mm-hmm. And the risk takers. We talk about the ADHD, the impulsive type of behaviors, and the people that have this attraction to risk and danger. And then the other way, you have people that are risk aversive and they never challenge, they never go forward. They reduce their abilities in terms of love and relationships and work abilities. So there's really a lot of self-damaging behavior, some more extreme than others. Like if you go to suicide on one end, and if you go to the other end of, in terms of risky sexual behavior, if you're married or any other situation. So there's a lot of, just a lot of things. I think it's wise for a person to take a time out and kind of take a look at themselves and say, what's going on here? Are there things that I'm doing that are self-destructing me, that are really causing severe issues in my life personally, professionally, socially, whatever it might be. And I think it's important. And I think we all know people that do things. I think every one of us, to some degree, self-sabotages ourselves. We don't do what we could do. We miss the brass ring, as the saying goes. So we do want to be realistic, but we also want to be safe, okay? And we want to be judicious. So I think on the one hand, the proverb, look before you leap, and he who hesitates is lost. I mean, those are kind of contradictory, but somewhere in the middle, you do want to just make good judgments and move forward in life, and that's really what we want. I just work with and know a lot of people that just make bad decisions, and they have to live with them. So, whatever you can do to make your life more reasonable. And you know, you can seek out friends, you can seek out family, you can seek out therapists, you can seek out medical doctors, you can seek out group, you know, group work. You can do whatever you need, but there are resources. So the question is, what are you going to do?
But, Doc, to do that, you have to have a degree, too, of not being, you know, blinded, have a degree of self-awareness. Do you think enough people have that not only are they self-destructive, but they're aware that it's occurring and they know it's a problem, but maybe they don't know, or they feel paralyzed, they don't know how to approach it, how to get help?
Well, I think that is true, because a lot of people really do have a goal. Like, I think we could talk about the kind of stereotypical weight loss goal on January 1st of every year that kind of stops within a month. I think a lot of people don't want to be in isolation. They don't want to relive bad events that keep them, you know, the PTSD, if you will, post-traumatic
stress,
keeps them out of things. The question is, what do you do to overcome it? Now, of course, there are some that seem to enjoy risky behavior and doing things that can cause issues for them. But I think most people, most drug addicts in terms of substance, most really know there's a problem. And they often will say, I want to stop, I'd like to stop, but this is meeting and more of a need for me now. And they continue down that road. So it's and apparently, you know, the pleasures and joys of the addiction, they're wonderful. Certainly, if cocaine hits you right, I mean, from what I hear, it can be so overwhelming. We see it, okay, in people that the joy is so pleasure and so wonderful that they want it, and they'll take the risks. And afterwards, they might say, "I don't want to do that. I'm trying not to do that," but they do fall back in. So it does take a lot of steel behavior, you know, the strong steel of the personality to say, no, I'm not going to, and then seek out support. That's another thing. There are helplines. There are a lot of resources available if the person really wants to. In fact, often the social isolates, the person who has really exceptionally low self-esteem, these are the people that often have the hardest time to change, even more than the risk takers, because often the risk takers are full aware of it and they can try to work on that, like the gambling, like the shopping, call it what you will. But the really isolate, the social isolate, the person who's the social phobic, these are very hard for people. And these are really often very good people. I mean, in fact, maybe we could say most of these people are good people. They just have these self-destructive behaviors that damage them in life. So we just want to make ourselves available to find people that can help us, as well as taking an inventory of ourselves and working at this. And a lot of people do this, Dave. In fact, a lot of people, you could say that a personality is like a garden. You have to work at it every day. I mean, you have to be looking at, you know, what are the positive aspects of.
Well, what about those around them? Okay, but let's talk about people who see this going on. It's a family member. It's a close friend. It's a colleague. When and should they intervene and try to assist if the person isn't following? Is there a point where that's okay? To a certain extent.
Well, I think in extreme cases, you do have to have sometimes intervention, you have family intervention, there can even be police intervention, depending on what we're talking about.
Right.
But I think as a whole, I think if we know a good friend, we can just say, you know, you've just really been kind of out of line lately. It could be a friend who all of a sudden is drinking too much. Okay, I'll just take alcohol. And you see it and you begin to see a pattern, and you can just mention to the person, you know, you're kind of doing some things, saying some things, and kind of risky. You've been driving, which is a threat to you and threat to someone else. And
So
I think we can do that. I think people do that, and good friends and relatives. I mean, there's some people you can't give any advice to. They get mad about everything. You know, particularly if you're dealing with a personality disorder, these are people that really can't interact effectively, you know, with other people. But as a whole, I think we do have friends Cicero's thing about a close friend is another you. So I do think that they're in friendships and families and interactions are, that people are advised and helped when they're going too far. It could be in a bad relationship. It could be whatever it might be. So there are these interactions that can be helpful, but there are some people that are so bent on self-destruction, there's really nothing you can do. This can lead to suicide, lead to imprisonment. This can lead to tremendous problems at work. It can lead to tremendous problems with family, with raising children. There is that element. Fortunately, the vast majority of people with issues, and most people have issues, can be dealt with themselves or in coordination with friends, with family, with therapists, with physicians, with organizations, so church groups, clergy. So there's support. The person has to be willing to, to work at it, and particularly sometimes with the eating disorders, which can be so devastating. Mm-hmm. They don't even make sense if you're dealing with someone who's anorexic. They're getting, smaller and really unhealthy, and they think they're heavy and big. I mean, these are, you think of Karen Carpenter, just when the singer, many, many years ago, people.
Perfect example, a tragic one, right.
A really tragic, or believe me, I'm taking some of these things that they just don't make sense. But if you, in my work, you run into them, or in life, the regular road of life, you run into unreasonableness. So we really do have to examine our conscience, examine ourselves, and be available to other people and give good advice if it's appropriate and you can do it. And there are times you do need intervention to when people are really doing dangerous things and they're really, really a threat to themselves and something else.
Self-destructive behavior of a psychological, physical, and or both origin. I think, the line of the day might be personality is a garden. That was good. And every garden needs a good weeding once in a while and taking some stock there as well. The good doctor, Dr. John Braccio. The podcast will reside at drjohnb.com. Regional Psychological Services, East Lansing. Always good to talk to you, my friend. Take care.
Always a pleasure with Dave. Let's enjoy this beautiful day.
Stay safe. And this weekend, go green.
Go white.
We'll see you later. 1320 WILS.